Stragglers are in.
Yes.
I mean, if they are coming from another lecture, yeah, possible they might
drop it. That's fine. Yeah. So. I won't embarrass them. Some people still having lunch up at the back. So. Yeah, sure.
Right, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to today's talk. Just before we begin, and before I introduce today's speaker, can I just remind you that if you have got any phones with you, which you all will have, of course, if you could just switch them to silent throughout the talk. Thank you very much for that. I'm absolutely delighted to be able to introduce James Ramsbotham to you today. James is the Chief Exec of the Northeast Chamber of Commerce, and I'm going to allow James to introduce himself and the work of the Northeast Chamber as he talks to you. But I think it's really important to grasp, I think, just how significant a voice the NECC is in the region. It's one of the major voices of business and industry in this region, working in partnership with other organizations like the Northeast LEP and other representative bodies. We were just talking a moment or two ago about some of the difficulties that this region faces in trying to make itself heard above the noise that comes from bigger conurbations like Manchester and Liverpool, Birmingham, London and the South East. And in the fight for scarce resources, it's really important that we have a voice such as that represented by James today. So without further ado, I'm going to pass you over to James and say welcome.
Great. Well, thank you very, very much indeed. And really pleased to be with you this afternoon. And for many of you, from my behalf, on behalf of the business community in the Northeast, a huge welcome to the Northeast, because many of you don't hail from these parts to start with, and I'm going to spend quite a bit today of trying to demonstrate to you just what a phenomenal part of the United Kingdom the Northeast is. But first, just to introduce myself and what the Chamber of Commerce is. I've had a fairly varied career. I started life as a soldier, and worked in the Far East, in Central America, Africa, Europe, Northern Ireland quite a bit. Probably most memorable moment as a soldier, which is particularly pertinent at the moment, is that I went out and trained and then commanded the counter-terrorist force at the Winter Olympics when they were in Calgary back in 1988. A Winter Games that I suspect some of you may have heard of. I guarantee none of you can remember a single gold medal winner from those games, but many of you might have heard of two of the great Olympic stories. One was an Englishman called Eddie the Eagle Edwards, who had glasses the sizes of the bottom of milk bottles and leapt off the ski jump rather badly. And then there was the Jamaican bobsleigh team, and that was the first outing that they've had, and of course, right this week, they've again hit the headlines and are so positively supported everywhere. After I left the army, I went to work in banking. I worked for Barclays Bank for 14 years, mainly up here in the Northeast on the corporate side, and eventually going to be marketing director for the business bank down in the City of London. And I then left that to come and run a construction company up here in the Northeast, a business called the Esch Group that I suspect many of you haven't heard of, but it employs about 1,500 people, probably doing about 100 million turnover now. And a whole range of really great projects there. And I left that about 8 years ago to come and do this job. As well as doing this, I'm also chairman of a small building society, the Darlington Building Society, based in the south of the region. And I do a lot of work with a number of other organizations. I'm honorary colonel for my old regiment, which is particularly pertinent this year as the centenary of the First World War is coming, and a lot of activities are going to be surrounding that. And I work with Durham Cathedral, all the universities in the Northeast in one way or another, and several other things. Now, the Chamber of Commerce is something that I suspect you all might know a little bit about, but I doubt that anyone knows as much as you probably need to really understand the benefit you can get from chambers. Because wherever you come from, there will be a Chamber of Commerce. It's the most amazing global business organization because there is a chamber in pretty much every single city around the world. And That's important because we have always been there to enable international trade and enable businesses all the way around the world to do business with each other. And much of the things that we set up to do was to really work together to make sure that businesses could trade together internationally, so that actually when you put something on a boat to send it to a far-flung part of the world, you could be fairly certain there was some money coming back in the opposite direction. A fairly crucial role that Chambers have played for many, many years. And indeed, this year is our 200th year. Our 200th birthday will be on the 5th of January next year. For people that know a little bit about European history, that was about 6 months before we went and gave the French a bit of a pasting at the Battle of Waterloo. And there's a certain amount of subsequent history that went with that. But throughout our history, we've been engaged with encouraging international trade. Indeed, the members of the Northeast Chamber of Commerce contributed quite a lot of money to help build the Suez Canal, because we were so desperate to build trade with Asia and beyond, and the Suez Canal was a key part of that. So throughout the last 200 years, we've been engaged with that way. What is different, however, around the world is the way that some chambers of commerce run. And I've been to visit chambers in Japan, in China, in the Middle East, in Africa, all around Europe, in North America. And each one is run slightly differently. So it's worth explaining how the British ones run, in that the Northeast Chamber of Commerce is its own independent organization, and we are a mutual organization. That is, we are owned by our members. So the 4,000 businesses in the northeast of England that choose to join the Chambers of Commerce, they are my bosses, and that's the people that I'm answerable to and that I work for. Nobody else. I'm not paid by government. I'm not paid by anyone in London or anything else. I'm purely here to champion what northeast businesses want. And indeed, every Chamber of Commerce around the United Kingdom operates on that basis. It's a mutual organization in the same way that building societies are mutual organizations owned by their members. So we're owned by the businesses in the northeast to deliver for them. In other parts of the world, it's different. In some places, the Chambers of Commerce are part of the government machine. In some places, they're set up under statutory arrangements. In some places, they're limited companies. But we believe that the mutual model is best, because I have to really fight to make sure that I am delivering for business and that business want what I do well enough that each and every year they make that decision to continue in membership and to pay my salary and the salary of the 150 people that work for the Northeast Chamber of Commerce here in the northeast of England. So what do we do for them to convince them of that? Well, international trade is a key part. We spend a lot of time building international trade, building links with chambers around the world, providing support, providing guidance to businesses, providing the documentation that they need in order to conduct the international trade that they need. We also run a small training company. I say small, we've probably got about just over 1,000 apprentices that we train. They are all employed by businesses here in the Northeast, and we go out and make sure that they are receiving the training that they need and really helping to deliver skills. Because whenever we ask our members, there are always three things that they put absolutely at the top of what they want us to campaign about, and skills is always number one. The other two, which I'll come back to, are transport infrastructure, and in fact, that I should broaden that to infrastructure in general, which includes digital infrastructure, energy, water, waste, but transport is always high up there. And planning is another issue, which there's some very specific issues as to why planning is always at the top of our agenda. So we do international trade, we do training, and then the main thing that really we do is to champion the Northeast and to fight for business in this part of the world. We have some very specific issues to do with the way that business gets its voice heard. And many of you come from places where the way that the political system works is very, very different. But one thing that particularly Western democracies are finding is that increasingly the voice of business doesn't get heard. Now, you will all be aware that under British law, when you create a business, when you create a limited company, in law you create an individual, because that business has all the same rights and responsibilities as a person. So it exists in law as an individual. But it doesn't exist in democracy, because only people human people can vote, not a business. And because increasingly in this country, more and more people live and work in different constituencies, there is a really fundamental thing that's happened that people don't always appreciate, is that people vote with their domestic head on rather than their business head. Now, to give you an idea of the way that that works is that if you went just south of here into the eastern part of County Durham, the traditional Durham coalfields, 50 years ago, if you'd gone to a village probably 10 miles from here and asked them if you would like, if you could sink a coal mine and put a pit at the end of the village, they would have all gone, yes, please, because that's our jobs. You go back there now and they'll say, no thanks, we live here. And the value of our houses is such that actually that might devalue our houses, and we prefer you didn't do it here, that you did it somewhere else. And business is increasingly being pushed out, and we've got to make a real fight to make sure that the importance of business is maintained. And it's happening in many Western democracies that organizations like us are becoming ever more important. I had an interesting discussion with a politician recently, a very, very senior British politician, was a minister for many years under a previous government, who turned to me and said that he felt that chambers of commerce were not representative enough. So I challenged him and said, on what basis do you make that statement? And he said, well, you've only got about 10% of businesses in the northeast of England in membership. And I said, oh yes, but the 10% that I represent probably represent over 40% of the people employed in the northeast. And I reckon that's pretty huge, because it's 40% in any measure is a massive amount of the total piece. And he said, no, but you know, 10% just isn't. I said, okay, in which case, are you basing representation on paying membership? And he said, yeah. And I said, well, I think if you ask businesses to vote, they would see it very differently. And if you actually take that line, I challenge you as to just what percentage of the population is in paying membership of your political party. He hasn't spoken to me since. Because I know that it's 0.01% of the population is in paying membership, and politicians often confuse the difference. We don't ask businesses to vote, either for the Chamber of Commerce or in democracy, and therefore we don't understand quite the way that the voice of business works. But it's our job to make sure it's heard. And in doing that, we spend a huge amount of time working with businesses, bringing businesses together on a whole variety of topics. We probably run about 200 events a year with businesses in the Northeast, either just events to bring them together so that they can meet, so they can do business together, so that they can increase what they do, but also in order to get their feedback and their views. And one example that if you go onto our website you can find, and I'm afraid I haven't got one with me here today, but it's something that we call our annual manifesto. This year it's the Manifesto for Growth. And we will start in about September and go and basically go around all of the businesses in the Northeast and ask them what it is that they want us to fight for over the next 12 months. And we collate that together, and we eventually try and condense it down to something that is no more than four issues or four major issues. There's various sub-issues, and put it together into an 8-page document. And it's done in such a way that we push it back out and say, you know, have we captured the main points? Are there any things that you think should be covered that aren't? Are there any things you disagree with? And we gather all that feedback, refine it, so that by the 2nd of January, the first working day of the year, we can send it out to every single politician in the Northeast and anyone who has any influence over the region. Basically with a little label on saying, this is what I'm going to give you a black eye for over the next 12 months, and so don't say I didn't tell you. And then we proceed to do exactly that for the next 12 months. And we feed back to our members throughout the year to say how we're achieving that. And that forms the main piece. But the main thing that our businesses really, really want us to do at the moment is to shout for the Northeast. So one of the things that we've produced is a thing called the 50 Great Reasons for Doing Business in the Northeast. And if any of you want copies of this, it is on our website, not as a Z card, but as a, basically you can print it out, probably best on A3 because the writing is quite small, but on any size piece of paper. And it lists all of the great reasons for doing business here in the Northeast. For those of you that have studied any English literature, Don't confuse it, because I was doing a lecture recently to an organization called the Inspiring Females Conference, and one of them tweeted about it subsequently and got it slightly mixed up and wrote the 50 Shades of Business in the Northeast. It's an extremely exciting read, but it's not quite in that genre. It has been translated into Mandarin, Japanese, Russian, Arabic, French, and German. So there's no excuse for someone not to be able to understand some of the messages that we've got in there. What I really want to do for the rest of this talk is explain some of the great things that this region has got to offer, which many people never really understand. Now, many of you, even if you don't know the region that well, have been around for a little while now. So if I was to ask you that over the last 3 years for which we have measurements, and I'll explain that those are the years of 2010, 2011, and 2012, because we've only, in November last year, we finally got the official regional statistics for 2012. So the last 3 years for which we've got official statistics, and England is divided up into 9 regions: London, the South East, the South West, East Anglia, West Midlands, East Midlands, North West, Yorkshire, and the North East. So out of those 9 regions of England, do you believe that comparing GDP growth per head of population, so GDP growth per capita, was the North East in the bottom third, the bottom three, the middle third, or the top third? So let's go. Who would say that they thought the Northeast was in the bottom third? Yeah, it's a couple of half hands, a little bit of indecision around the room. What about in the middle third? Yeah, a few more. So the rest of you all think it was in the top third. Okay, well, I'll challenge those of you that think it's in the top third. So out of those top three, were we in number three, number two, or number one? Who thinks that we were number three? A few. Number two? And number one. Hey, one. Fantastic. So one person believes that the Northeast outperformed London, outperformed the Southeast over the 3 years 2010, 2011, and 2012. Well, be proud of your minority, because you're absolutely right. And how often does that message get out? It is really bad. The Northeast is actually one of the top performing regions across all sorts of measures. And I'll share a few with you. We're the only region in Britain with a positive balance of trade. We actually have a positive balance of trade of just over 3 billion. It'll come up in a slideshow I'm going to show you a little bit later. To my very simple way of thinking, that means to me that the Northeast is the only part of this country that actually continually makes a profit for this country. It's not quite the way we're ever portrayed. And to give you where that is that the UK as a whole exports about 19% of everything that it makes and does, but in the Northeast it's 34%. We are incredibly well connected globally. In fact, the tragedy is that we are the only part of the United Kingdom not connected to any other part of the United Kingdom by continual motorway, but we're much better connected to the rest of the world. And we make the most of it. That is so important. And what's more important is that over the last 6 years, we have doubled our exports. So in the teeth of one of the toughest recessions this globe's ever seen, the Northeast has actually doubled its exports. And most of that growth has come from outside Europe. Because when we went into the recession, we were doing over 60% of our exports to Europe. And we're now doing only about 47% to Europe. And when you consider how they've both grown, it shows the exponential growth that we've had in exports to other parts of the world outside Europe. But there are so many other advantages that people don't understand. Now, you've all, without doubt, looked at the weather forecasts on the BBC over the last couple of months and thought, Britain's getting a pretty good deluge. Well, there's no coincidence that the word sun is in Sunderland, because we haven't quite had that weather over recent months. And we all have a sneaking suspicion that actually the weather in Britain has got a lot worse since the BBC moved from London to Manchester. Because they now know what rain is like. Because if you've ever been to Manchester, it always rains in Manchester. Worse in Northern Ireland, actually. they do seem to have commented on the weather so much more over the last 18 months since the main part of the BBC moved up to Media City in Manchester. And then, of course, they've had loads of excuses over the last couple of months. But you will have also seen comments that one part of southern Britain, the Somerset Levels, that has now been underwater for 8 weeks, is pretty miffed that as soon as Surrey beside London got flooded, suddenly the amount of resource was totally unlimited. And yet they've been sitting with water up to there for weeks. And it is something that does seem to happen, that we are much too much centralised on London. Quick little statistic for you, but if you look at the top 20 cities in Europe, I think Germany has 5, I think France has 3 or 4, Spain has 2, Italy has 2, most countries have more than 1. Britain only has 1 city in the top 20 in Europe. But if you graph them all, 19 of them are all at that level, and 1 is way up there, which is London. The problem is that the rest of the country is down here. And we have a huge imbalance between the rest of the UK and London. And about 4 years ago, despite the amount of rain that we've got at the moment, we had hosepipe bans in Britain. There were droughts. And the only place that didn't have a drought, really, was the northeast. We've got a reservoir up north of here called Kielder. And if it didn't rain for the next 23 years, there'd still be a drop of water at the bottom of Kielder Reservoir as long as our demand is at the same level as it is now. So when this drought hit the rest of the United Kingdom, the Mayor of London at the time said, we think we need to build a national grid. And we will basically take all the water out of the northeast and take it down to London. Cunning plan. It's not downhill all the way to London. I think he thinks it is. And water is quite expensive to move. But also, our water comes from peat uplands, and the southeast of England is chalk lowlands. And if you take peaty water and put it into chalk country, you kill everything in the rivers. So we did suggest that this wasn't such a good plan. What he should do is that we should find all the water-intensive businesses and ones that really needed it and move them to where the water is rather than try and move the water to where the business is. And exactly the same is true about energy, which people do not appreciate, is that when you transmit energy over long distances, you lose quite a lot of it. In some conditions, up to 10% of it that's conducted away when you're transmitting energy over 200 plus miles. And the southeast of England is a net energy importer, and the north of England is a net energy exporter. And actually, whilst it makes sense to have a national grid, it doesn't make sense to do it in the volumes that we do it because it's expensive and it's not very globally environmentally sensible, and yet we're doing it that way. So the national grid, which for those of you that don't know is the organisation that runs the grid to get all of the energy from where it's made to where it's consumed, is a monopoly. It's not state-owned anymore. There's a chunk of it that's state-owned, but most of it is owned through the stock market. But it realises that this is wasteful, and it wants to correct it. So the way it's decided to do it is to try and use supply-side pricing. Now, all of you are studying various different forms of economics and business studies, and I challenge you to find a situation where supply-side pricing really works. But it's what they're trying to do in this situation. And the way that they do it is basically to say that because if a person wants to set up a generating company or a generating station around the UK, they will price the energy depending on where it's going to be consumed. So Dungeness Power Station, which is down in the southeast, nuclear power station down in the southeast, I think is paid in the region of 20p per unit, whereas Hartlepool, just down the coast from here, is paid 8p a unit. And they do this on the basis that this is... they've only set up, you know, in their minds, you've only set up the power station in the north in order to feed London, so we're going to charge you on that basis. It simply doesn't make sense, because the motivation for doing it is to try and encourage more people to set up power generation within the southeast. And it ain't going to happen, because no one down there wants it. And what I said before about the business voice, it is really, really difficult. And if anyone thinks that they're going to set up a new power station in the most populated part of the country, they're going to have a hell of a fight on their hands. We've got the space up here to do it, and we've got the willingness to do it, but we haven't got the consumption to make it work. We believe that they should move the other way, and they should move to demand-side pricing. and that actually businesses in the Northeast should be given a substantial discount on their energy to encourage us to consume it near where it's being produced. And over 20 years, businesses would move to the Northeast to take advantage of this and move away, and it would rebalance the economy, but it would also make many of our businesses that are exporters, who are particularly energy dependent, actually more competitive. And 20 years, it would take that, but then an energy policy is probably 40 years anyway, so it's not extensive in that. It's one of the areas that we've got water, we've got energy. We've also got, right now, some really exciting opportunities. If you go down to the coastline here, you won't notice it, but actually out there underneath the North Sea is probably 500 years worth of coal that we can't get at. We can, but it's too expensive. Trying to bring up solid coal, and when they closed down most of the deep mines, they were already between 6 and 10 miles out to sea. But it starts to get really, really expensive to bring deep mine coal out from that distance. But there's a business here in the Northeast that is now working, and they think that they've perfected the technique to do coal gasification out under the North Sea and then pump out the gas. So we already have the facility and the ability to take coal and turn it into gas, syngas, that we can use not just for energy. In fact, many people would say it's a waste to use it for energy. We should use it for our chemical sector. And in the Northeast, we've got some phenomenal chemical sector facilities, particularly down on Teesside. But we also have access to a big chemical plant up in Scotland at Grangemouth. And the coal is right in the middle. And using modern directional drilling techniques, we can drill down, gasify the coal out under the North Sea, pump it out, and actually then use carbon capture and storage to pump carbon back in, so we can even make neutral. And the Northeast was built originally on providing cheap energy. In fact, at that time, not just to the UK, but to many parts of the world. And we're in a situation where we might go back to that. And it's just one of the many, many advantages that this part of the country has. So our mantra as the Chamber of Commerce is that, as opposed to the way many people see it, the Northeast is not a problem for the rest of the country to solve. It's an asset that we should be making better use of. And there are a whole raft of things that make that point. So before I finish and open up to questions, and I've got a few other points I want to make afterwards, I just thought I'd show you this slideshow, which makes the point about some of the strengths of this region.
There's no need to be afraid.
I don't know if you noticed there, but there was one slide which was talking about the strength of our manufacturing sector, just to give you an idea about some of the great things happening in this region. But actually, that slide's of a submersible that's being built. It's actually built and delivered now, that currently is working 3 miles down under the surface of the Pacific on an undersea volcano, mining for diamonds and gold. And if they could bring up all the gold that's down there, they would have a very serious impact on the world's gold price. And the machine was built here in the Northeast. And one of the things that we continually point out, and you'll have seen that there was quite a lot of emphasis in that on our ports and our airports, and it's trying to change the language of the way that people look at things. And I hope that you, in whatever you go to do in your businesses in the future, think about this. Because economic geographers, when they look at the United Kingdom and look at some of the strategic assets that exist, they draw things in a very particular way. And I know, I studied as an economic geographer. But so if you take the airports of the United Kingdom, they'll put a circle on every airport, and the size of that circle will be by the amount of traffic going through that airport. So anyone around the rest of the world looking on it will see that Heathrow is there as a huge, great airport, and therefore it sort of makes them think we really ought to go to that airport and be near to that because that's where everything's happening. I draw a very different map. I draw the one of how much more traffic can go through that airport without having to further invest in the capital infrastructure. And suddenly, Heathrow is actually very, very small, and Newcastle is really quite substantial. And that's important because I do the same for our ports. And if you go out and stand at the end of the pier, either here in Sunderland, up at the Port of Tyne, or down at the Port of Tees, or indeed any of the smaller ports in between, you'll be able to stand there and see a speck coming out of the horizon that will probably be coming from Rotterdam, and it will come straight in and come straight in, tie up, start unloading, reload, and go out again. If you go to some of our busier ports, you will see ships at anchor, waiting in many cases many days to come in and out. Now, if I'm moving goods around the world, I don't want it sitting at anchor. I want it straight in and it moving. And I think that we've got to change the way that we look at things. And to give you a sort of final thought of the way, from me, that I think things are changing. And people aren't waking up to this. But last summer, 400 ships came through the Arctic Ocean for the first time. It's like opening up a huge new canal for about 5 months in the year. It shaves about 10 days for a cargo vessel coming from China or Japan to Britain to come around that way. And the best ports in Britain, best placed to take those, are the ones up in the northeast of England, because they certainly don't want to go all the way down to Southampton. And it's going to change some of the dynamics. Now, we didn't open up that canal deliberately, but for better or worse, we've done it, so we might as well take advantage of it. And this region is incredibly well placed. So not only do I think that the northeast is in a great place now, I think we have a phenomenal future, and I'm glad that you're able to experience it too. Thank you very much indeed. And I'll take any questions. Stunned silence. Go on, George.
So great institutions like The Economist, Forbes, and New York Times usually say, or lately they say, that manufacturing jobs, they're going to stick for some reason. This is going down. There are not a lot of manufacturing jobs. And the Northeast is promoting manufacturing just in general. How do you feel like the employability is going to be in the manufacturing sector?
It's a really good question. And we have seen manufacturing jobs decline too much over recent years. And we've got a real skill shortage at the moment. I can give you any number of different areas where it's grown and waned and then grown again. Nissan probably provides the best example, and one that I hope many of you are aware of. In 2008, end of 2008, the bottom dropped out of the car market. And they had to suddenly go from having three shifts. They've got two lines making cars at the Washington plant. And they had to go down to two shifts on both, and therefore effectively shed probably about 40% of the labor force in a very, very short period. But they actually managed it incredibly quickly, and I'll just come back to a piece on that in a minute. But they managed it very, very quickly, and as a result, became very, very productive again. Now, they actually took the workforce down to just shy of 5,000 to about 3,800 at that stage. Beginning of this year, their level of employment moved back to over 7,000. But more importantly, to me, is that if you look at the whole of their supply chain, it's about 50,000, including the direct. So there's probably about 42,000 in the supply chain, 7,000 direct at the plant, very nearly 50,000. And the bulk of that is here in the Northeast. That has come with huge challenges, and it's come because we actually, although we have, on the face of it, very high levels of unemployment in the Northeast, we don't have nearly enough skilled labor in engineering and manufacturing. And we're having to work incredibly hard at the moment. I reckon that we're probably about 8,000 short of skilled engineers in the Northeast alone at the moment. We're trying to bring people from every other part of the world where we can encourage them to get here. But I have to show that slideshow to convince them they want to come here most of the time. But we're desperately trying to bring skills in, because part of the decline of manufacturing has meant that we haven't invested enough in the skills for it. Now, I just want to go back and touch on, because it's an important thing that a lot of you, particularly with what many of you hopefully will go on to do after you move on from here, understand. Because something very different happened at the beginning of this recession that woke up people's thinking as to the way that this happened. And if I speak to Trevor Mann, who was the boss of Nissan back in 2008-09, and is now actually working out in Yokohama in the headquarters of Nissan, but he was also responsible for the plant down in Spain in Barcelona. And they also had to shed about 40% of the workforce down there. But given the way that the European social chapter works, it is a lot harder to get rid of staff in certain parts of Europe, Germany, France, Spain, than it is in Britain. And we've got some very different arrangements. And people felt at the time that this was dire. We just let people go, and it all happened without any wailing or gnashing of teeth. But actually, that was very bad for our unemployment. However, when Trevor went to try and do the same thing in Barcelona, at one stage he needed 150 riot police just to get him from the plant back to the airport to get out of the country. They were burning his effigy in the streets, and he swore, as did the leadership of Nissan, that if ever they had an opportunity again, they would invest here where they could manage the workforce quickly, as opposed to somewhere where their hands were tied behind their backs. And thus we've seen the huge growth here. And we need to get that message out. And it's important that people understand the crucial role of flexibility of labor, that we can make it happen. But with that, we need the skills. And we've got to work really hard because we have allowed manufacturing to go down. We're working on a couple of programs at the moment called onshoring, reshoring, and northshoring, in that for many years Britain worked on offshoring, which was saying that because labour was so much cheaper in certain parts of the world, there were certain processes that we would move offshore and get them done in other parts of the globe, and that that was worthwhile. Over time, it's become much more evident that actually the supply chain needs to be closer to home. And this particularly impacted us after the tsunami in Japan, when a lot of manufacturing processes in this country realized that they had several weeks of their supply chain out on the oceans. But once that last ship had come in, there was a huge, great gap because the tsunami had done such damage to plants in Japan. And quite a lot of motivation to say, how do we bring more of that supply chain closer to the OEM, closer to where it's actually going to be put together into the final product? And we've got to tackle that. So onshoring is bringing it, is making sure that we do it here. Reshoring is actually bringing stuff back. And it's not just in Britain, it's happening all over the world. But then what we as the Northeast Chamber of Commerce have is northshoring, because once they've got it into Britain, we want it in the Northeast. So that's why we go for northshoring. And we do a lot more manufacturing in the Northeast. It's why our exports have grown, it's why our economy is strong. And this recession has shown us just how important manufacturing and engineering is. It is our heritage. We can do so much more. And because we've got energy and water and a lot of the other important things, and we've got people, we just need more skills that we can make it happen.
What, you know, great picture of the Northeast. What great, more impact, what can the universities in the region do to contribute more to impact and economic success?
I think there's a whole raft of different ways, actually, and it's skills in general is the first point, obviously. We desperately need so many more engineers, but I do understand that there are real challenges for universities bringing on engineers. I'm told, and you know, the people here that will know the figures better, but to get an arts graduate through is probably costing about half what the student loan is over the period, whereas it's probably three times that to put an engineering student through. But the university doesn't necessarily get recompensed fully for that. So there isn't an economic motivation for universities to do more engineering and less art subjects. But actually, that's what we need in the Northeast. And so there's a real challenge there. There's also then a challenge to convince those engineers that they actually stay in engineering when they've graduated. But that's another issue. So as part of that, what we desperately need to do is increase the links between business and university to actually find opportunities to get students out to see some of the great opportunities. Because some of the great businesses that I showed there, I suspect, aren't known to too many students here, and they don't therefore appreciate some of the phenomenal opportunities that are out there. And I can take you, you know, what are the businesses I've been to in the last week? Well, this morning I was down at a business just outside Middlesbrough making, well, they call them robots, which actually underplays what they are. They're employing 40 graduates and about 10 apprentices at the moment. And the thing that they were making that I saw today is something that is trying to find out to compare the amount of sugar in leaves of different plants so that they can do some work into biofuels. And in order to do that, they've developed a robot that will take a leaf, put it in a container, freeze it to minus 80. So that at minus 80, when it's frozen completely, they shake it in a container with ball bearings in it at minus 80, so that it becomes a powder at that temperature, which then allows them to analyze it in a way that you can't in any other way. But you've got to be able to, a scientist who sits on top of this, sort of making it all work, with it being minus 80 just there. And if you put a finger into that, it's a bit sore. And they've made 10 of these now. The one I saw today is on its way to Australia. But they're using them all the way around the world in various institutes studying biosciences. So it's really top-end stuff. There's a business that I visited last week, just south of Durham, called Cromec. Cromec make one of the very few machines in the world that you will shortly all use. It's on trial at Newcastle Airport at the moment. It's one that you can put any container in with whatever liquid in, and it can instantly tell you whether it's safe to fly or not. So that you will be able to take liquids onto aircraft. Now, that might not sound very clever, but just think about it, because there is there are a whole load of spectrographs and other things that can tell you, if you put a liquid into a standard beaker, what's in it. But they will quite happily take something like that blue one, which is probably metal there, is it? Or something that's plastic, or something that's cardboard. It doesn't matter what the container is. What this machine first of all does is works out what the container is, because it has to then take that out to then work out what the liquid is. And it's being made here in the Northeast. It's absolutely the forefront of technology. As a business that making plastic parts for the car industry, which I wish I could take every teacher in the region to, because I think so many teachers still believe that manufacturing is sort of rather smoky and black and dirty. And this place, which is making, you know, 500 million quid's worth of parts for the car industry, and you could eat any meal off the floor there anytime. And it's just, you know, those are just the first three that come to mind, because they happen to be the three that I've seen in the last week. We've got to get that message out to young people that these opportunities are here, they're right here in the Northeast, and we need people to do them today. So.
Can I just ask a very quick question, James? Look around this room, we've got a fantastically international student body here. In fact, the first time this year, the number of international students at the University of Sunderland has just slightly exceeded the number that come from the UK. And it just strikes me, the students in this room are going to go on and become some of the business and political leaders back then in the countries that they originate from. What can we do to exploit that as a region, to actually make sure that they take back, A, a positive message of the kind you've given them, but B, that they retain those links? Because I'm sure that many of the people here today would like actively to retain links with the region, will have very fond memories, very happy memories of being here. What can we do to around that?
You're absolutely right, and I hope, you know, a lot of what I've said is trying to pitch at that, because I hope that you will all go back to where, I mean, and come back here as often as possible, because the more we see you, the better. But when you do go back and undoubtedly and hopefully become really successful at what you do, you will want to invest in this country with, you know, you'll want to set up part of your business here, bring it to the Northeast, don't take it anywhere else. We've got all the assets you need. You know, I look forward to helping you do that and helping you set it up. But I think also the university has a huge role of really making sure that we use the alumni of the universities to actually keep in touch, to keep informing, to keep making sure that we build those links, and that we don't say, well, you've come here for a period, a year, a couple of years, 3 years, and then that's it, it's goodbye. Because actually, hopefully this is the start of a lifelong relationship, and it's not just a brief sojourn in whatever your life holds for you. I've got two children who are 26 and 23, and I had to do a talk for one of them recently with a lot of their friends while they were at university, and with a lot of the parents in the room as well. And I said to them, I want to let you all into a secret that nobody ever tells you. And I suspect many of you in this room, no one's ever told you this secret. But shortly after you graduate from university, something magic happens. You stop growing older anymore. In here you do, because any of us still think we're in our 20s, don't we? Is that right?
Yeah.
See, nods. You think we just look like a bunch of old farts, and of course we're. But actually, you know, we all still think somehow we're in our 20s. Mentally, we stop growing older anymore. So you've reached maturity here in Sunderland. Stick to it.
On that note, I think I'd like to say thank you very much to James for giving up his time. If any of you would like to come and have a very quick cup of coffee with James and continue the conversation for a couple of minutes, we'll be in RB104 for about the next 10 to 15 minutes. That's okay? So you're very welcome to come and join us for a free chat. Thank you.